Lord, sometimes it's hard to be thankful. We thank for all this going on around us with anarchy and uncertainty and riots and, Lord, just things that we don't understand. But Lord, your word forecast this would happen, but it also said, leaning on the everlasting arms and standing on the promises, we know that as your children, Lord, that you watch out and take care of us. We thank you for our pastor and his family. We thank you for each volunteer of our church. We thank you for our loyal staff and the job that they do each Sunday. Lord, to hold your word out, to lift you up, to not only our church, but our neighborhood. The Lord, forgive us of our sins, where we failed you, where we let you down. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. I invite you to stand as we continue with our time in worship. Let's sing out our praises to the Lord.
Thank you.
words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Talking about King David again, and we're going to be looking at another one of the Psalms that he wrote. This time it's Psalm 51. A lot of times when we think about King David, we think about how good he was and how faithful he was. But we also need to remember that even though he was a man after God's own heart, he also messed up and sinned quite a bit in his life. And so in this Psalm, this is King David praying to God, and he is talking to God about all of the sins that he has committed, about how he is covered in blame and guilt. Now, we know when we talk about the feeling of guilt that it's something that kind of makes our stomachs upset, right? We know that we've done something wrong, and we just feel yucky about it, and we can't quite move on. Guilt is an emotion that we often talk about as being heavy. It's a burden, and it's hard to carry, okay? It's something that's not easily forgotten by us, okay? And so here we go. We're going to take King David, and here he is feeling really guilty. Okay, can you see his little face? He's sad because he's so guilty. He knows that he has taken things that don't belong to him. He knows that he even used his power to make orders that ended up with somebody being killed. So he's feeling really, really guilty about all the bad things that he's done. So we're going to put him in this water, and he's going to sink to the bottom because guilt is heavy, and it makes us sink. Now, we also know that we have a God that loves us, and while he doesn't want us to mess up and do bad things, he also comes back and forgives us. We have a God that will restore us, right? He wants us to be clean and blameless again so that we can do his work and share his love with other people. So in this cup, I am going to add our faith, okay? And it's actually little bitty grains of salt. There you go. We're going to put our faith in there. And these are all the prayers that David is sending up to God. And he's in this psalm, he says things like, wash me clean from my guilt, purify me from my sins, right? He says, give me back my joy. Okay? He wants to be better. He wants to feel better. He doesn't want to be stuck with all this guilt. So now here we have King David. This time we're putting a smile on his face because he has prayed and asked for forgiveness. And with all of his faith, we're going to drop him in there. And he floats instead of sinks. That's pretty crazy, right? So when we're talking about salt, it's teeny tiny. Would you have thought that salt had the power to make this egg go from sinking to floating? Probably not. But our faith is like that. Sometimes our faith is really hard to see, but it's there. And if we use it, and we pray to God, and we ask for forgiveness, and we recognize all the things we're gone, he can take the guilt that we're feeling, and he can remove it so that we can float back up and be restored. All right, are you guys ready to pray? God, we come to you today, and we are so thankful for your power. We are so thankful that we have somewhere we can run when we have messed up. We are so thankful that we can give to you our guilt, that heavy feeling that brings us down sometimes. We are so thankful that we have a Savior and a God that is willing to carry those things for us and pick them up off of our shoulders. Amen.
Came in this morning, you noticed at each door a basket, and that's to receive our offerings. Times will change a little bit when we don't pass the collection plate, but we still appreciate and need the gifts that you can give us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, again we come to you. Lord, we know that you're the giver of all things. Lord, it is this morning as we turn to you a portion of what you graciously have given us. Now, Lord, we want to use this to spread your word, to change lives, to change worlds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we sing the doxology as part of our offerings to God.
Especially if you're a visitor, if this is your first, second, third time here, fill those cards that are in the front, in the pews in front of you or right next to you, and let us know that you came to church. Let us know if you want a phone call, if you want, if you need some help with groceries or whatever it is that you need, especially if you have a prayer request. Please let us know. We'd like to pray for you. When we ask if you have any prayers, we mean it. And we pray for each other. So today is no different. We're going to pray for some prayer requests. We're hearing from y'all what you like your church to pray for. And so today is a great opportunity so that we come together, whether this is our first time here or whether we grew up in this church, we pray together and we have the certainty that God is listening. Before we pray, I'd like to encourage you to do one thing. Picture God right in front of you. You come and you see him right there in front of you. He's listening, he's looking at you. As we come to pray, picture God right there in front of you because he's listening. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, what an amazing gift and opportunity it is to close our eyes and picture you, your greatness. And I'm sure we all have a different picture. We all see a different face. Some of us are not even able to put a face. And all we can see is your feet. Some of us, it's easy to do. Some of us, it's hard to do. But God, one thing is for sure. And that's that we can come to you and have the certainty that you are listening. Lord, it's so amazing to know that so many people pray at the same time. Not just here in our church, but in millions of places around the world. As we pray right now, there must be another church somewhere in the world praying to you. But Lord, it is amazing to know that it doesn't really matter how many people are praying at the same time. You hear our prayers. What an amazing God you are. That you don't pay attention to some people more than others, but you hear our prayers. And so, Lord, we come today to pray. We come today picturing you right in front of us because you are. We have needs, we have burdens, we have flaws, we have dreams and goals. Lord, we just bring everything to you today and lay it at your feet. Father, we pray for our friends, brothers, and sisters who are struggling with health issues. Those who are dealing with COVID, God, we pray that you keep us safe from COVID as we continue doing everything in our power to be safe and keep those around us as well safe. God, as sometimes we just know that we cannot give each other a hug or a handshake, but our hearts can share that love that we receive from you each day. God, we know that there's many people struggling with cancer, a terrible disease that it's hard to fight. And we pray, God, to you, the God of the impossible, our healer, to be with those whom we know who need your healing hand for this particular disease. We come together, God, today to pray for those who are traveling and those, Lord, who have lost a family member or someone they love. Be with them, we pray. Give them your peace and your joy in the midst of and in the middle of the storm. God, thank you for blessing us today with your presence. And as we study your word, we pray that you open our hearts and our ears that we may hear it and be transformed by it. And Lord, today we also come together to pray this beautiful prayer that you have left us through your Son, our Savior. And together we pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Is I'll come to the altar, and it may be unfamiliar to some of you. As Belinda and I lead you in this time, I invite you to remain seated, to meditate on the words that you see on the screen, and to join in, to sing with us as you feel led. But most importantly, let us prepare our hearts to hear from God.
Thank you.
scripture this morning, 51st chapter, Book of Psalms. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence, and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, I was born guilty, a sinner when my mother conceived me. You desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all of my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a living spirit. Then I will teach transgressions your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from bloodshed, O God, my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you have no delight in sacrifice. If I were to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased. The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure, rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in right sacrifices, and burnt offerings, and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Just a quick recap in case you weren't here last week. And again, you can go online and find the sermon from last week. We've been talking about a sermon series called A Story of Restoration Behind the Psalms. And we're talking about King David. We're talking last week, we talked about Psalm, the 23rd Psalm. What a great treasure in Scripture. We agreed that that was one of our favorite Psalms in the whole book, and even in the whole Bible. And we talked about the author of this psalm, King David. We talked about some, we shared some fun facts and some interesting facts about this book and the different authors. Especially talked about the author, King David. And there's much content in this when we talk about King David. And the Bible describes King David as a man after God's own heart. A man after God's own heart. I don't know about you, but that's a great description. A great description. Have you ever wondered? You know, you picture God right in front of your eyes before we pray, right? Have you ever wondered how God sees you? How God would describe you? We have the nice lady over here, have the cool grandpa right here, have the funny guy over there, you know. How would God describe you? Have you ever wondered that? David was described as a man after God's own heart. And that, I think, I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. You are a person after God's own heart. Well, as we continue reading the story of David and his life, we find out that there are certain things that he did, certain attitudes, certain commandments or commands that he gave, certain things that he did that makes us wonder, how in the world and why would God define someone like David as a man after his own heart? But before we get into that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, once again, we pray for your presence to be with us, that you help us understand your word and make it ours and live your word. Speak to us today, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Sure, we all fall in love with a good-looking shepherd. The Bible tells us that David was handsome, that he had beautiful eyes. Now, this is found in 1 Samuel chapter 16. He was young, strong, brave, passionate. We like the guy. Then he fights Goliath. He stands up in there, something that no one was willing to do, and he kills the giant. Oh, and he earns everyone's respect and admiration. So, of course, we like him. And later on, he writes this pressure scripture in the Bible, Psalm 23, that for many of us is our favorite. And he just keeps on doing great things and gaining a good reputation. Of course, we like the guy. What a man of faith. But you know what? David was not perfect. In fact, he was far from it. David was a king who did wonderful things, many great things in his time. But he also made terrible mistakes. Now, I've encouraged you to read 1 and 2 Samuel, if you're not familiar with the story. And if you have, great, you'll know, you know, what I'll be talking about. If you haven't, go home and work on it. It's a novela. It's a telenovela. You're going to love it. Has some ups and downs, and so much it's found in there. And as we continue reading the scripture, we see some of the mistakes that David made. He lied to the priests. He lived among the Philistines with Goliath's sword, and he was killing people all over the place and getting into all sorts of trouble, to the point that he had to pretend that he was crazy to get out of problems and circumstances, tough circumstances, where his life was at risk. He literally pretended to be insane. He failed as a parent, as a dad. He didn't bring that discipline to his sons, and he paid the price for that. He ignored a good advice that later on brought tragedy to the whole nation, to the whole kingdom. Now, I don't know about you, but when people talk about David, and they refer to David not as the man after God's own heart, but as the man who was a murderer, a man who was a mercenary, a proud and reckless king, an adulterer, kind of hurts. It affects my heart in a way. You know, we're building this reputation. We've worked so hard. We've killed many giants. We've done great things. It's like people say, you know, people will remember not for the thousands or millions of good things that you do, right? Oh, but that one mistake will follow you for the rest of your life. Unfortunately, David was these things. He truly was someone who committed sacrilege. He killed people. He stole. He lied. But perhaps the most famous failure that is registered in his life in the Bible is his scandalous, I'm telling you, it's a novela. It's a soap opera. This scandal of his sin with the neighbor, Bathsheba. And then he even tries to cover it up by killing Bathsheba's husband. And we find this story in the second book of Samuel, chapters 11 and 12. Let me give you just a quick highlights of the story. King David, again, picture him laying in a couch, 11 a.m. The sun is hitting and heat, no AC running. Has his hands full of Cheetos, dirty, his beard looking bad shape, He wakes up and starts rubbing his belly and starts walking around the palace and see what happens. While his army was fighting a battle where he was supposed to be, and he just kept walking until he found a window. Now, as I said in the early service, I will keep this sermon PG rated because we have some kids here. But y'all know what happened. And you go to your Bible and read it, 2 Samuel chapter 11. He saw through the window. He asked people to bring the neighbor. He sinned. Bathsheba called and said, I'm pregnant. What do? You messed up. You try to fix things. You bring the guy, the husband, and you say, hey, why don't you go home? And then you find out that there's an honorable man, even more than you, when you say go, and he says, I will not do that. He spent the night right there in the palace at the door. Because he said, I will not go home to my wife when all my army is dying, being killed. I will not, sir. So then he keeps on planning things. He practically killed him by writing a letter saying, put him in the toughest spot, in the front lines, and charge to the enemy. And Uriah was killed, covering it up. And so, what happened later? Oh, God sent someone to deliver a message, a prophet. We jump to chapter 12. Nathan comes in, sent by God, and he has a message to deliver. And he uses some stories to explain something to David, using the same example, pretty much, that he did, using a rich man and a poor man, and these men stealing from these other one. And so David hears the story, and he says, you have to kill that man. He deserves to die. And he gets all rattled, and he just gets so mad. And then Nathan looks at him and says, you are that man. What? So that's what we see in the scripture. The moment where our hero experiences sin, shame, and that moment when Nathan came and said, you are the man, something broke in David's life and heart. I like to read it in this way. 2 Samuel chapter 11 first, then 2 Samuel chapter 12 late, and then at the end, Psalms 51, because even in some of your Bibles, it'll have a title that says that King David wrote this psalm when he was rebuked by Nathan for what he had done with Bathsheba. So that just helps us understand the timing. So this time in his life brought brokenness to King David's heart. And to me, there are two Davids in the Bible. There's the David before Psalm 51 and the David after Psalm 51. In other words, there's the David before he sinned with Bathsheba and after. And I see that reflected even in the Psalms that he wrote. If you look into the Psalms and you try to put them, which is not easy to do, and it wouldn't be 100% accurate, but you try to put them in a chronological order, there's a difference in the inspiration that he has before Psalm 51 and then what comes later. He adds new words to his vocabulary. He talks about other things. There's a different taste in the poetry of the Psalms after Psalms 51. Now, many things began to fail in King David's life and family. Many things started changing after his sin with Bathsheba. And I feel like he was lost. Not completely, but he experienced his trust and confidence going down. I don't know if that has ever happened to you. That you feel like, you know, I ask you to picture God right in front of you, right? Well, now try to picture no God. Try to picture that image that there is no God. What do you mean? I mean, there's no God. He's not there. You come, you pray. He's not just, you know, not willing to listen, but he's just not there. Your prayers are useless. And I think that at times, David felt that way. Now, here's the thing that, though, David kept on writing. He kept on singing. He kept on lamenting and doing all kinds of things. He didn't quit going to church. He stayed close to God. Broken, but he stayed close to God. You see the difference? So many times we run away so fast when we feel like we've lost that relationship with God. The first thing that you do, you quit coming to church. I've been there. Because we're not worth it, because we don't feel like we can have that access, because we need to get things straightened up first and then come back, right? How are you going to come through those doors carrying all that dirty thing around? But David kept on writing, and I believe this is beautiful because he didn't run away. He stayed close to God. And this is where Psalms 51 comes in. The writings that David left us are describing what he really is going through in his life. Everything is falling apart. Things are not working out. And this is known to be one of the seven penitential psalms, or psalms of confession. Out of 150, seven are known to be penitential psalms. They are dark. They talk about sin and that dirty, dark feeling that sin brings to our hearts and life. Like Children's Moment was saying, you feel that in your stomach. Seven penitential psalms. 51 is right there in the middle. If you want to know the rest, Google it or come ask me later. Psalms that express sorrow for sin. Now, we shouldn't be surprised that David is writing these type of things. You know, he's full of emotions, regrets, tears, pain, and even death. In fact, even half or more than half of the psalms can be considered a complaint by the way they are written. Almost half of the book of Psalms can be considered as songs or prayers of grief, disappointment, or urgent pleas for help. But that's the thing. That's what I love about the book of Psalms. They are so honest. They are so down to earth, so true, so relevant. They even apply to our lives today, because we go through all that mess, don't we? And King David is no different. He is writing thousands of years ago, and he's feeling the same way you and I do. The Psalms shows us a picture of human reality, our struggles, our brokenness, our defeats. And they also show us the greatest picture of it all. God's redeeming grace, powerful redeeming grace that comes to save a wretch like David, like you, and like me. Like we sing when we sing Amazing Grace, that's one of the verses. So even in the complaining, most of the authors and the poets wrap up their complaints by expressing their gratitude for the Almighty and true God. So there's no doubt that our important character and friend David experienced some dark valleys in his life. Remember, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, there's no doubt that he went through that in his life. It's all over the Bible. And some of them were someone else's doing. Saul chasing him, chasing each other like cats and dogs. But some of them were, and perhaps the most important ones in his life, they were not something external, they were something that he did, his own doing. And that's why we talked about that last week, about how sometimes when we pray and we talk about you deliver me from the evil one, you know, you prepare a table and God protects you, you anoint my head with oil, that protection that we have from God, that includes ourselves, because sometimes the greatest pain comes from the things that you do to yourself. And we become our worst enemy. And we need saving from ourselves, from our flesh. And so he experiences those times. And these stories shares with us the climax and one of the highlights and most important things that David went through, Psalm 51. This is the time in which David's heart, soul, mind, spirit, strength, wisdom, trust, confidence, and all those great things that we talk about him were crushed completely. That powerful and wise king that we once heard about, respected by everyone and feared by everyone around him in all the nations, experienced brokenness. That guy experienced brokenness just like you and I do. What a bitter taste to experience this brokenness. Again, those times in which we feel like we have failed so bad that there's no way that you have the right to come and kneel in the altar. Because there's no way, and you feel it in your stomach, you feel it in your heart. How can I do it? We feel God completely disappearing. He used to be right in front of me when I prayed. He's closed the doors. He's disappeared from my life. And I think that David felt that disconnection for a little bit in his life. He experienced that taste, that bitter taste. At that point in his life, he felt that God was hard to reach. Now, to be honest, I have felt that way too, many times. And it also applies when you're a leader in the church or a pastor or something. It applies to you, always. Even Jesus Christ. Remember what we said? That fun fact number 5 last week? That the book of Psalms, that most of what happened in the crucifixion and death in Jesus' story in the New Testament, and most of Jesus' words from the cross were prophesied in the book of Psalms. And then they're being reminded to us in the New Testament. Remember when Jesus Christ, while being on the cross, bleeding to death, looks into heaven and says, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, "Father, Father, why have you forsaken me?" You go through life and experience those disconnections, and you experience that brokenness, and you experience that pain and bitter taste that God is not there, that God is not listening, that he doesn't really care. Now, David should have been dethroned, banished from Israel, executed for adultery and murder, separated from God, and damned to eternity. That's what he deserved. Instead, he was forgiven, he was restored, he was allowed to stay in power, and he was given the everlasting covenant of being part of Jesus' lineage, part of his descendants. And this is where I always thank God, and I truly do. It doesn't matter if I preached this 30 minutes ago, I still believe and thank and say, thank God that he doesn't give me what I deserve. Thank God that he doesn't give us what we deserve. And we just saw a perfect example from a great man in the Bible. Instead, he gives me grace, he gives you love, patience, forgiveness, and he restores me like no one and nothing else can and ever will. He anoints my head with oil. Remember that? Because God knows that oftentimes I act like a dumb sheep. Remember, he anoints my head with oil, and that gives me the chance to be set free of those thick bushes. Oh, there's plenty of ground around. Oh, but we know who we are and how we are. Oh, look at that bush. It looks interesting. Let's go check it out. And we get ourselves in thick bushes. But he anoints our heads with oil, giving us that protection and that assurance that he goes with us. And that is a great image. But how can something broken be made even more beautiful than before it shattered? And here's where I explain this picture that you see. When you and I are getting our breakfast ready, and we're pouring Cheerios or whatever cereal you like. And all of a sudden, the plate falls into the ground, and what's the first thing that you do?
Yell at the kids.
Yell at the kids, and then we clean it up and throw it away. You don't need it anymore. You get it clean and throw it away. You dump it. Well, there's a Japanese tradition, and pastors have preached about these things on several occasions. Some of you might be familiar with this. There's a Japanese tradition in art that they take a broken vessel and they restore it using gold, liquid gold, or other precious metals. So instead of doing what we would do, that just dump it, they bring the pieces together, they put it on the table, and start using liquid gold or a precious metal to put it together and make it back to where it looks nice. And you know, when they do this, they fix what the things that have been broken, but it also significantly increases the value of the piece. So much more valuable than before it was broken. Right? Because now it has gold in it. May not look great. Oh, but it's valuable. It's precious. Now, I believe, if you think about it, that God does something remarkably similar in our lives. After all, how can David be called and described as a man after God's own heart? After everything he did, come on, he's done way worse than I have in my life. So, God's going to be pretty cool with me. He's going to describe me in a nice way. After all, he did that with David, and it all went well. See, the one thing that David did was that he never leaved God's presence. He was always there. He didn't do what you and I sometimes do. He didn't escape right away and got lost, and then the pastor has to be calling you, hey, what's up? Oh, nothing, I just have a little work. That's normal, everyone. That happens to all of us. But David gives us a great example of never leaving God's presence. Broken? Yes. But still right there with him. He knew that what he had done, and he stayed with God. And love, God's love towards David was greater than David's sin. God's love towards David was greater than his sin. And that applies to you and to me today as well. God's love towards you is greater than your sins and flaws and imperfections and brokenness. Yeah, of course, David failed people. He failed his family, his soldiers, himself, his God, just like you and I do. But there's one thing that David did. He confessed. He repented. And I guess it's true what we come and say every Sunday, that we have Communion Sunday, which will be 2 weeks from now. We're all invited, by the way. Every time we come together and we prepare to be part of the table and take communion, the bread and the wine, or grape juice, we read something from a book or from the screens, and we confess and we say, merciful God, we confess that we haven't loved you with our whole hearts. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. I don't know if you've ever felt forced to read those words, but y'all, that's what we do. We fail. And that's what we need. We need to confess. And then we say, forgive us, we pray. Now, we are sinners, but our past and our sins and our mistakes and our brokenness did not determine God's affection for you and for me. He still wants us to be his friends, his children, and his servants. All we need to do is what David did. He genuinely repented. And he knew how to do it because he spent so much time with God. He knew that he didn't want any sacrifice just like that. He wanted a contrite, is that the word? Contrite heart. He will not ask for you to leave when you bring that to him. A broken heart, an honest heart. That's all he wants. And here's the thing. This is not up for you to fix. There's no way you will be able to clean your own mess. It doesn't work that way. You will never be able to clean your own mess. We all need God's hand at work in our lives to clean that mess. My prayer today is that you realize that God still wants to use you, that He's not done with you. But first, He wants you to enjoy His restoration process. Some of us, it takes longer than others. Some of us, it might be painful, but trust me, and use it from David's example. We need His restoration. Now let me ask you, what has been broken in your life? What is broken in your heart? What cracks are inside of your soul? It doesn't really matter how tough you are, or how much you know about God, or how many years you've been in these pews or church. Our hearts are fragile. The Bible tells us through Solomon, David's son, in Proverbs 4:23, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." Now, like David, we all experience brokenness through things that we do and through things that are out of our power, external things. And we will talk more about that next Sunday. But I encourage you to think of these things that you know that must be restored in your life. And be honest with yourself. I'm not going to ask for you to come and confess those things. You do that with your God. Trust me. He is right in front of you, and He's listening. Hear this song as you think of your relationship with God. And think about the great men who wrote the book of Psalms. They were honest. They didn't care. They were honest with themselves and with their God. So what things need to be mended in our hearts? Restoration because he understood one simple truth and secret that I'm about to reveal to you. David knew the secret of running after God instead of running away from Him. I'm going to read that again. David knew the secret of running after God instead of running away from Him. David was far from perfect like I am, like we are. But he always and constantly kept pursuing the one perfect God. May we find ourselves chasing the loving arms of Him who has the power to restore every broken thing in our lives, in our hearts, in our souls, in our families, in our marriage, in our friendships. God loves you, and he wants to be close to you. And he will, like we saw today, he will restore to us the joy of his salvation. Because in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Amen. Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Give him time and don't run away. He will finish what he started. He will restore to us the joy of his salvation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.